John was totally confused after the series of events happened that night. He was standing at a point where two roads diverged. One road back to his safe and boring life, and the other, the one less traveled, full of uncertainties and life-threatening dangers. Three voices simultaneously echoed his brain. The first voice, negative and dark as a demon, shaking him from fear and advising him against the move. This voice was the voice of fear. Fear of failure. Fear of looking like a fool. The second voice, bright as sunlight, and saying, "Hey, this might be the last chance to do anything worthy. You have got the ability. Go for it." This voice was the voice of courage. The third voice was the voice from comfort zone, which was saying, "Why to put so much effort and why to take this much risk? Just sit back and relax. You'll never get out of this world alive anyway." And all these three voices seemed logical, but only one can be chosen. He looked at Victoria. There was an irresistible confidence in her eyes. The confidence of having no regrets, which he always wanted to have. But his life till now was full of regrets. He said to himself, "If I died and die with no regrets, but if I didn't help her, I would again be the same person that I used to be. If life has given me one chance to do anything worthy, I'll do it, even if it costed my life itself." He took a deep breath and with a deep voice asked her, "What is the plan? Will you really help me?" she asked. "Yes, I will," he answered. "I don't wanna be in regrets anymore." Victoria sighed and with a bit relaxed voice answered, "We have to drive to a place almost 25 miles from here. From there, we'll fly directly to Russia." "But there is no airport within 100 miles from here. How will we fly?" he asked. "Don't worry, John. We have a private plane and I am the pilot," she answered. "You're a pilot? You're also an agent. What else are you?" he asked. "Many more things, John. You'll know in the journey itself. But we can't stay here for long. They know I'm in this city, and within hours, there'll be hundreds of them in the city searching for me." John and Victoria slept for the rest of the night, and they left the house in the morning. Victoria covered her face so that she won't be recognized, and they started for their destination. They both were hungry, so they stopped at a restaurant on the way. The restaurant didn't have a take-home service, so they had to sit there and eat. They both were eating and suddenly they realized that this was the most foolish mistake they could have committed. They saw four men entering the restaurant. John immediately recognized them. They were the same people who broke into his house last night. They also saw John and immediately recognized him. And after seeing the gun with him, they understood the whole matter. Both the parties gazed at each other for a moment, and all of a sudden, all the four men started running towards them. Victoria immediately took out her gun and squeezed the trigger, and a single shot got fired. The bullet penetrated his head, blasting it like a watermelon and spreading blood all around. He collapsed then and there, but the rest three were still running towards them. She shot another bullet, but it missed the target. John and Victoria rushed towards the car. Victoria asked for the keys. John agreed. Victoria started the engine and squeezed the accelerator pedal. The car started to sail into the busy traffic. John looked into the rear view mirror. Two Range Rovers were approaching them. "Drive fast, Victoria," he shouted. "We are being chased." She accelerated it further. The accelerometer reading crossed 80 miles per hour. When the car came to an intersection, Victoria eased off and made a hard right turn at the very last second. The Range Rovers were getting closer and closer. John's face was white with fear, but Victoria seemed quite relaxed. She again applied the brakes, pulled hard on the steering,
and accelerated through a 90-degree skid in the right direction. "Where are we going?" he shouted. "Outside the city," she replied. Very soon, they were outside the city on the off-road. The traffic vanished, except for those two cars behind them.
John's ancient car was already being pushed beyond the limits, and it was certainly not fit for off-road driving. The tire blasted and the car ran out of control, tumbled on the off-road terrain and turned upside down. Victoria somehow managed to get out of the destroyed car, but John was stuck. He could taste the coppery blood pooling in his mouth. She pulled her out and they both found themselves surrounded by the Range Rovers and three men. "Can I give you a genius piece of advice? Don't run. It will only hurt more if you do. Give us the pen drive and we will give you an easy death. Otherwise, it's gonna be very painful for you," one of them said in a very overconfident tone. "Why do you think that we need to run?" Victoria said. There was a creepy smile on her face. And suddenly, she started running towards them. She jumped, squeezed her legs and kicked two of them on their faces and stood right in front of the third one. He threw his forearm at her, but she dodged it, came behind him, grabbed him from his waist and lifted him off the ground and threw him on his head, breaking his neck. The other two men threw themselves at her, but she slipped to the side, pushed one man's elbow, caught his head and twisted it. She was fast as lightning. There was only one man left. He ran towards her and tried to punch her, but she dodged it, grabbed his arm, came behind him, put her shoulder beneath him and lifted him off the ground and slammed him back on her knee, breaking his backbone. All this happened so quickly that John was totally stunned. Till now, what he just saw in movies happened right in front of him. He had never seen a girl or even a man fight like that. He watched her as if a child was seeing magic. "What are you?" he asked in wonder. She smiled but said nothing. She got into the Range Rover. "Come on, John, we don't have time to waste." John got into the car and they started for their destination. He thought to himself, maybe the most innocent faces are the wildest. After some time, they reached an isolated place. It had a road and a large horn on its side. They got off the car. "Is this the place?" John asked. "Yes, this is it," she replied. They got near the horn. There was a large gate and a small dial pad near it. Victoria typed some numbers on it and the gate opened. John went inside and what he saw gave him goosebumps. In front of him was a Russian combat aircraft Sukhoi Su-30, the emperor of the sky, an aircraft so powerful that can cross the entire Pacific Ocean in a single stroke. This machine was a beast. John had never seen anything like that in his entire life. They got inside the plane. Victoria took the pilot seat and started the engine. The aircraft began to move. It got out on the road, which was long and empty for the takeoff. The plane started on the road. "Take a deep breath, John," Victoria said, and it started to accelerate. 30 knots, 50 knots, 85 knots, and it lifted off the ground. As it gained elevation, John felt the G-force produced by the powerful turbojet engines. It was like his chest was being compressed, but soon things became normal. John's life took a very steep turn. Till yesterday, he was just an employee, a mediocre serviceman. But in the last 24 hours, he got fired from his job. He saved a girl from a terrorist organization and saw people being killed in front of him. And now, was flying in one of the world's most powerful aircrafts. In front of him at the horizon, he could see the curvature of the earth, and beneath him was the giant Pacific Ocean, soft but strong at the same time. The ocean was breathing, its surface rising and falling with rhythmic ease. The waves were like its burns, the echoes of the stones it kept safe inside it. With tears rolling down his eyes, he could do nothing but sit and stare at the tranquil beauty of the royal blue. It filled him with respect. The magnitude of the Pacific gave him strength. He thought to himself, "Whatever be the outcome, I will never regret this decision." It was only in these moments of wilderness can he find out who he truly was. They were flying at a pace of almost 2000 km per hour. After some hours of flying, the Asian landmass became visible. An hour later, they reached above an off-road terrain with the airstrip at center. They landed there and got off the plane. Some soldiers were waiting there for them. "Who are they?" John inquired. "They are the Russian commandos," she answered. They approached closer. "Who is this man, Victoria?" one of them asked with a shout. "We don't trust strangers. Don't you know this?" "This is the man who saved my life. This mission would not have been possible without him. His name is John," Victoria answered. His anger turned into gratitude. "Hi, I'm David, Russian paratrooper and the mission in charge. You guys did a great job. The entire Russian army will be grateful for both of you. But we can't stay here for long. We have to get this pendrive to the military headquarters as soon as possible," he said. "Are we still not safe?" John asked. "No, we are not. The terrorists are here. We have to drive to the headquarters. It's 40 miles from here," he added. "We could be easily spotted during daytime. It would be safer to travel at night," Victoria suggested. "I think you are right, Victoria," David said. "We will wait till midnight. Till then, we will rest at our secret location." "The secret location? What is it?" John asked. "You will know it very soon, John. Have patience," David replied. "But firstly, give me your mobile phone." John gave his phone and David crushed it with his rifle.
"What's wrong? That's my mobile phone,"
John exclaimed. "We can be easily tracked. It was necessary to destroy your mobile phone."
"Don't worry, you'll get a new one," David replied.
All of them sat in the cars and after some time they reached the secret location. It was a house in the middle of the forest. Victoria and John slept for some hours. They had a very rough day and they were very tired. They woke up and all of them had dinner. It was almost midnight. Victoria and John were standing at the balcony. It was nice in the dark and quiet.
"Why do you do this, Victoria?" John broke the silence.
"What do you mean, John?" Victoria asked. "I mean, on this risk and no career certainties, you can't even be sure if you will be alive or not the next day.
Why to live such an insecure life with no future safety?" John asked.
Victoria smiled and answered. "Do you know, John, that for the pretty much entire history of human species, the average lifespan was less than 30 years. You could count on 10 years or so for real adulthood, right? There was no planning for retirement. There was no planning for a career. There was no planning. No time for planning. No time for a future. But then, lifespans started getting longer and people started having more and more future. And now, the life has become future.
Every moment of your life is lived for the future. You go to high school so you can go to college, so you can get a good job, so you can get a nice house, so you can afford to send your kids to college, so they can get a good job, so they can get a nice house, so they can afford to send their kids to college. And the process continues forever.
You can see how fake it all is. I have lived in my hometown for 16 years. And I have never come across anyone that cares about anything that matters.
And once you go inside this fake world, you will never come back.
I don't want to be one of those. I don't want a safe and scripted life. I love my work. Every day, every moment is a surprise for me. I'm not saying that everything is survivable, but As long as I don't die, this is gonna be one hell of a story. She made a 2-inch gap between her index finger and thumb and said, "Do you see this gap? This is your comfort zone. It's this big, John, and all the things that you want in this world are way out there. And the only way to get them is to take a step outside your comfort zone. One day, you will be about to die, and your whole life will flash before your eyes. Make sure it's worth watching." Here's a piece of advice, John. You are cute when you are confident, less when you are not. John heard on this and probably everything inside him broke. His eyes were filled with tears. He remembered all those years of his life he wasted not living them, just because he didn't have the courage to step out of his comfort zone. Victoria came closer to him, wrapped her arm around his shoulders, pulled him close, and gave him a hug. Her embrace was warm, and her arms wrapped around his body. The world around him melted away as he squeezed her back. In that moment of feeling her so close, he was more alive than he had ever been in so very long, not wanting the moment to end. His eyes were looking back at hers, like there was something in her worth seeing. A promise of realness and a passion that ignites. Something more romantic was about to happen, but David interrupted.
"Hey, just cut the romantic stuff. The mission is not over yet. Do this after the mission, not now." Everyone laughed.
They were standing at the balcony when all of a sudden, Victoria saw a red laser dot on John's chest. It was a gun laser. They were being spotted.
"John, move!"
Victoria shouted and pushed him. A bullet flew past John's head, just missing it.
"They are the terrorists. We need to get out of here now!" Victoria exclaimed.
They immediately left the balcony, after which it was bombarded with bullets.
"Get into the car, quick!" David screamed.
All of them got inside the cars. David, Victoria, and John were in one car and the rest of the commandos in other. They started the car and bugged out of the forest. The terrorists chased them and bombarded bullets on their cars. But they were no ordinary cars. They were bulletproof military vehicles and had a rocket launcher fitted on their roof. One of the commando fired a rocket launcher at the terrorist car and it blew off in the air.
"Are there more of them?" John asked.
"Yes. We will surely meet them again on the way.
We have to reach the headquarters as soon as possible," David answered.
They drove for their destination. The headquarters was now just a mile away when they saw a truck behind them with a rocket launcher on its roof. David knew who it was.
"Drive fast, they are right behind us."
"We are very close to the headquarters now," he exclaimed.
And all of a sudden, a rocket launcher blowed just by the side of their car. The blast was so powerful that both the cars tumbled. Everyone got out and immediately a gun war was started. It was still dark. David fired a flare night gun in the air, spreading light and sending signal to the headquarters, hoping that they wouldn't see it. A bullet penetrated through one commando's leg and another one hit at the car's fuel tank, blowing it off in the air. David shot down two terrorists, but there were still more of them.
"We can't hold them for long. There are too many,"
Victoria exclaimed. Very soon, they were surrounded by terrorists.
"I hate to say this, John, but this might be the end of the road. We have no bullets left," David said in a hopeless tone.
One of the terrorists came forward to shoot all of them. John closed his eyes. But suddenly, they saw something that filled their faces with smiles. The Russian army arrived there. Hundreds of paratroopers loaded with weapons, marching in sync to destroy their enemy. Jeeps loaded with machine guns started to open fire on the terrorists, penetrating their bodies with bullets. A rocket launcher blowed off their truck in a single shot.
The army killed every terrorist and carried the injured soldier to the jeep. Everyone started to get back to headquarters. Victoria was about to sit in the car when she saw that a terrorist was still alive and had pointed the gun at John and squeezed the trigger. "John, move!" Victoria shouted and pushed him away and came in front of the bullet. The bullet struck her on the heart and she collapsed. David immediately shot the terrorist and everyone ran towards Victoria. As she was about to collapse on the ground, John just grabbed her. She was bleeding. "You'll be fine, Victoria. Take her to the hospital, David, now!" John screamed. They picked her and put her in the jeep and started driving towards the headquarters. John grabbed her in his arms. "Why, Victoria? Why have you done this, you stupid?" "I can't even share your pain," he said in a sad voice. "It's not even there, John," she said in a weak and trembling voice. "No, no, Victoria, please don't go. Please, no," he started crying. "It's okay, John. It's okay. This is my fate. I'm dying with no regrets. And neither will you. Promise me, John. Promise me you will live your life to its fullest." "I promise, Victoria," John cried.
"Anyways, I was going to die someday, but dying in your arms is worth dying for. I love you, John. I love you." She grabbed his hand tightly. John kissed her on her forehead and hugged her.
"Please don't go, Victoria," he was crying hard. "It's okay, John. It's okay. You'll be fine. Let me go. And just remember, you are cute when you are confident." And she released her last breath. Her grip loosened and her hand left his hand and fell on the ground. John hugged her tightly, but this time Victoria didn't hug him back. She became quiet forever, resting in peace in the arms of his lover. They reached the headquarters, but it doesn't matter now. Victoria was dead. John sat there, crying and hugging her, hoping that she would wake up again. But she didn't. Every soldier, every commando out there was filled with rage and anger. Every face was sad and every eye was filled with tears. David wiped his tears and shouted at the peak of his voice, "Victoria's death won't go in vain. Prepare the army. We are going on a war." They checked the pen drive and took out each and every location of the terrorist camp. The entire Russian army got out for the battle against terrorism. Fighter jets, submarines, tanks, helicopters, and thousands of Russian paratroopers set out to all the parts of the world to destroy terrorist camps. And within 24 hours, each location was captured and destroyed. Every terrorist was killed and Russia became a safe nation again. John decided in the headquarters. The army returned after succeeding the mission. John was appreciated by the military heads. Everyone was happy. Everything was perfect. Just that Victoria was not there.
Later that night, John was standing at the balcony and reflecting back on the recent events. His mindset was completely changed and his comfort zone was shattered. He realized that it was actually in those moments which took his breath away that he truly lived.
For whatever he lost, it was always himself that he found in the journey. It was raining. He looked at the sky and remembered Victoria. Tears started rolling down his eyes. He remembered everything. Her admirable eyes, her gentle touch, the wisdom of her attitude, and the warmth of her hug. He took his head out of the balcony. He felt like Victoria was watching him from the heavens above and smiling at him. The rain felt like her soft fingers wiping his tears and touching his lips, and the breeze felt like Victoria hugging him again. He remembered her last words and cried out and thanked her with all his heart for everything she did for him. He loved her for what she was and decided to live his life to its full potential. Victoria was gone. The memories were not. What a beautiful thing to believe that a person is more than just a person. Victoria was no miracle. She was not an adventure. She was not a fine and precious thing. She was a girl. Maybe we all resemble John in some aspects, in terms of our fears, insecurities, and anxieties. And maybe there is a Victoria hidden inside each of us in the form of courage, curiosity, and passion, eager to burst out of us.